Good evening, sir. On a weekend, to be connected on a topic which every student of law, and student of law also includes a lawyer himself, because they say as long as the student within oneself survives, one can always improve himself within the different facets of law. And while taking different webinars on different perspectives, a topic which normally is being discussed is burden of proof vis-a-vis onus of proof and standard of proofs. The modes of proof and the variation of these proofs have always been a facet which we all, as a student of law, intend to learn amongst each other. Amongst us, the today's resource person is Justice M.S.R. Murthy, a former judge of Andhra Pradesh High Court, and his passion for making the knowledge spread is also amplified from the fact that he also had a major role in the Andhra Pradesh Judicial Academy, as he is himself a gold medalist. And we all say that, and we all learn that once you speak a knowledge which takes you to a different level, that itself gives you a feeling of gold. And I was, while we had requested Justice Murthy, we also said that since we always bring resource persons of immense knowledge, the either ways we can go gaga about is biodata, but we always feel the participants always wish to have the deeper insights and plunge deeper into it so that they can understand the nuances of law from a person who has been not only the established name as a practicing lawyer, and thereafter as his judge when his judgments were and are being well received and well read. Without taking much time, I would request, sir, that we are enamored by the fact that you have accepted our invite to share the knowledge, and that too on a weekend and during all these testing times. Over to you. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, one and all. My hearty pranams to all the elders, including the respected senior advocates and justices sitting and retired who may be participating, and all the others. Good wishes to all youngsters. I thank the organizers and the team of Beyond Law CLC for inviting me to share my humble views and thoughts on the chosen topic. It's my distinct pleasure to be with you this evening. As rightly said, law is an ocean. Its horizons are ever widening and its depths are unfathomable. Therefore, every lawyer and a judge is forever a student of law. For me, interacting on subjects of law and participating in webinars is like learning. Coming to the topic, burden of proof vis-a-vis onus of proof and standards of proof. I would submit first that my talk is intended for youngsters, newcomers, both at the bar and on the bench, and also young law students. Law of evidence is an interesting and intriguing subject. In stating so, I purely mean it is a fascinating and absorbing subject. Any presentation on any topic related to law of evidence without mentioning Sir James Fitzjames Stephen will be doing injustice to the great man who is responsible for the masterpiece, the magnum opus on the law of evidence. Since I already said my talk is intended for the youngsters I shall start with a brief outline of the Indian Evidence Act 1872. The Act has three parts. Part 1 consists of two chapters. Chapter 1 consists of four sections. Section 1 deals with title, extent and jurisdiction. 2 is not on the statute book. 3 interpretation clause, a very important clause. 4 presumptions. Chapter 2 deals with relevancy of facts, contains sections 6 to 58. Part 2 deals with mode of proof. It consists of chapters 3 to 6. Chapter 3 deals with facts which need not be proved. Sections 56, 57 and 58. Please underline the word fact wherever it appears. Chapter 4 deals with oral evidence, sections 59 and 60. Chapter 5, documentary evidence, sections 61 to 90. Chapter 6, exclusion of oral by documentary evidence, sections 91 to 100. Part 3, production and effect of evidence. It consists of chapters 7 to 11. Chapter 7 is burden of proof, underline, sections 101 to 114. Chapter 8, estoppel, sections 115 to 117. Chapter 9, competency and compellability of witnesses, sections 118 to 134. Chapter 10, examination of witnesses, sections 135 to 136. Chapter 11, improper admission and rejection of evidence, section 167. Thus, having considered the outline of the Indian Evidence Act, let us come to the topic. Generally, a person goes to a court of law and initiates a legal proceeding in order to seek redressal of any injustice caused to him. In such a case, he necessarily relies upon a particular rule of law provided either in a statute or derived from case law. Ibi jus, ibi remedium. Where there is a right, there is a remedy. Therefore, the person who goes to a court and initiates a legal proceeding is required to show that he is entitled to a certain right or that the other party is subject to a duty or a liability. Thus, the party who goes to a court of law will accept existence of certain circumstances and facts. The other party generally denies the existence of the same. Then the facts in issue become the subject matter of the court's decision. So everywhere we are talking of facts. Thus, all rights and liabilities of individuals necessarily arise out of facts. Then what is a fact? Indian Evidence Act clarifies that facts are of two types, physical facts and psychological facts. Physical facts are those which are capable of being perceived by the five senses. Facts which can be perceived by these five bodily senses are physical facts. What are the five bodily senses? For youngsters to easily remember, I suggest these are drushya, sravana, sparsha, rasa, gandha. Drushya, the power to see, sravana, the power to hear, sparsha, the power of touch, rasa, the power of smell, gandha, the power of smell, rasa, the power of taste. Then what are the psychological facts? These are the facts of which a person is conscious. They are subject to consciousness, namely intention, animus, etc. These are all psychological facts. They are incapable of rendering direct proof. So the same can be proved by admissions or confessions or by presumptive evidence. Presumptive evidence is evidence which can be drawn from other surrounding physical facts. These are the facts which become facts in issue when facts are accepted and denied by the parties in a list. So when one party asserts the existence of certain circumstances and facts and claims that he is entitled to certain rights, and when the other party is subject to a duty or liability, but when the other party denies the same, a question would arise as to who should be asked to prove. In other words, the question is, on whom does the burden of proof lie? On whom does the burden of proof lie? Thus we come to the topic, burden of proof. When we think of burden of proof, what comes as a first thought to our mind is Section 3, Interpretation Clause of the Indian Evidence Act, which particularly deals with proved, disproved, and not proved. These are the definitions which we find in the Evidence Act. Evidence means and includes all statements which the court permits or requires to be made before it by a witness in relation to matters of fact under inquiry. Such statements are called oral evidence. All documents, including electronic records produced for the inspection of the court, are called documentary evidence. But at the end of the trial, we notice that there will be a third kind of evidence in many a matter. That evidence we know is material evidence. So at the conclusion of the trial, either in a civil or a criminal case, there is a possibility of having a third kind of evidence, namely material evidence. You can see Order 13, Rule 11 of the CPC, which says provisions as to documents applied to material evidence. And the material evidence is material objects producible as evidence. Then coming to proved, disproved, and not proved, this is very, very important for us because we are talking about burden of proof. A fact is said to be proved when, after considering the matters before it, the court either believes it to exist or considers its existence so probable that a prudent man ought, under the circumstances of a particular case, to act upon the supposition that it exists. So there are two kinds. The court believes or acts on the supposition. Disproved. A fact is said to be disproved when, after considering the matters before it, the court either believes that it does not exist or considers its non-existence so probable that a prudent man ought, under the circumstances of a particular case, to act upon supposition that it does not exist. So the definition of expression disproved is converse of the definition of the expression proved. Then what is not proved? Here there is a very important aspect which I would like to share. A fact is said to be not proved when it is neither proved nor disproved. This does not always mean that no evidence at all is adduced. It's not a case of non-adduction of evidence. It also indicates a state of mind in between the two expressions, proved and disproved. That is, it cannot be said whether a fact is proved or disproved. It negatives both proof and disproof, despite evidence being on record. So the burden of proof thus signifies an obligation on the party to prove a fact. Ordinarily, burden of proof lies on the party which affirms a fact and not on the party who denied it. This principle accords with the common sense, as it is much easier to prove a positive than a negative. See Order 18 of the CPC, dealing with hearing of the suit, examination of witnesses, all youngsters at your leisure. But then the question is as to by what standard a fact can be proved. What is the standard which the court requires to come to a conclusion that a fact is proved? This question takes us to the standard of proof. Dealing with the jurisprudence, both civil and criminal, in the present context, it is necessary to refer to two phrases regarding the two kinds of standard of proof. Though the Indian Evidence Act does not significantly make a distinction between the standards of proof required in the criminal prosecution and in civil cases, however, it is now well settled that in civil cases, the rule of standard of proof is preponderance of probabilities, whereas in the criminal cases, it is proof beyond reasonable doubt. The two phrases or clauses are not mere small groups of words standing together, but they are two distinct conceptual principles. It is explicit from the two standards which I mentioned that the standard of proof in a criminal prosecution is of a higher standard. Now, I shall deal with, for convenience, first the preponderance of probabilities, which is a standard of proof in a civil case. Preponderance of probabilities is the settled legal principle for standard of proof in a civil case. A fact can be proved in a civil case by mere preponderance of probabilities. This normal rule governs civil proceedings. The standard decision, in my humble view, for this proposition is Narayan Ganesh Dastane's case, 1975 AIR Supreme Court, 1534. We have already made the reference to Section 3 regarding proved, disproved, and not proved. Under the Evidence Act, Section 3, a fact is said to be proved when the court either believes it to exist or considers its existence so probable that a prudent man ought, under the circumstances of a particular case, to act upon the supposition that it exists. The belief regarding the existence of a fact thus is founded on balance of probabilities. Here we come to the point that preponderance of probabilities. So the belief regarding the existence of a fact thus is founded upon balance of probabilities. A prudent man, faced with conflicting probabilities concerning a fact situation, will act on the supposition that the fact exists. If on weighing the various probabilities, he finds that the preponderance is in favor of the existence of a particular fact. So if the preponderance is in favor of a existence of a particular fact, the prudent man acts on the supposition that the fact exists. So therefore, the first step in this process is to fix the probabilities. Then the second step is to weigh them, though the two may always intermingle. So in the process of evaluation of evidence, what the court does in this standard of test is, first of all, the impossibility is weeded out. In the second stage, the improbability is weeded out. Then what remains is what is probable. Then we come to who has to prove. We know what is the burden of proof, what is the standard of proof required in a civil case. Generally, the rule is he who asserts must prove. But there may be circumstances where there may be a reversal of burden of proof. Say, for example, the presumption under Section 138 of the Negotiable Instruments Act, where execution is admitted, the presumption is the consideration is passed. Therefore, there is a reversal of burden of proof in that case. That is why, in a civil case, the standard of proof is very, very important, because unless we have a broad idea of this standard of proof, it is very difficult to mean concentrate on the issues. In fact, even to settle the issues that are to be determined and on which the court's decision rests ultimately. For example, every issue, in my humble view, must be framed in the affirmative only, unless there is a rule reversing the burden of proof. For example, in a suit on the foot of a promissory note, if the defense is total denial, the legal burden being on the plaintiff, the first issue will be whether the suit promissory note is true, valid and binding on the defendant generally. We will not employ the word not in the issue because the issue must be in the affirmative. So when we remove the word whether in the issue and we read the statement, the suit promissory note is true, valid and binding on the defendant is a statement which generally the plaintiff makes. Therefore, the issue indicates that the initial onus of proof or the burden of proof is on the plaintiff. Take another case, illustratively. The suit is for recovery of money on the foot of a promissory note on the basis of a promissory note. The defendant admits execution but denies receipt of consideration. In view of the presumption which I mentioned under section 118 of the Negotiable Instruments Act, 118 of the Negotiable Instruments Act, there is a reversal of burden of proof. Therefore, when once the execution is admitted, the presumption is that the consideration passes. In such a case, keeping in view the standard of proof and also the preponderance of probabilities, the court frames an issue whether the suit promissory note is not supported by consideration because of the reversal of the burden of proof. When we close the word whether and read the issue, the suit promissory note is not supported by consideration is an assertion that the defendant makes. Therefore, the issue indicates that the burden of proof is on the defendant. The initial onus is upon the defendant. But here we have to keep in mind one aspect. What is a presumption? Presumption is an inference drawn by a court as to the truth of a particular fact from other known or proved facts. So we don't just draw a presumption without any prima facie case. For one to draw a presumption as to the truth of a particular fact, there must be some known or proved facts. Take the earlier case. What is the known fact? The defendant admitted execution of the promissory note. That is the known fact. From that, we draw an inference that the consideration passed. So presumption is not itself evidence, but only makes a prima facie case for the party in whose favor it exists. Therefore, a presumption exists in favor of the plaintiff insofar as a promissory note where the execution is admitted. It makes a prima facie case for the plaintiff so far as the passing of the consideration and shifts the burden to the defendant. So when this is the presumption, there is a tendency to draw presumptions and inferences without there being a prima facie case. That is why it is very important to know this fundamental principle as to what is a presumption. When both parties adduce evidence despite a presumption, in my humble view, after the adduction of evidence both by both sides, the significance of the presumption is lost. The presumption pales into insignificance because the evidence will determine the true nature of the fact to be established. This is to be borne in mind insofar as civil litigation is concerned. In this regard, I request the attention of the youngsters to a decision in Sodhi Transport Corporation case, AER 1986 Supreme Court 1099, wherein there is a wonderful explanation about presumptions. Sodhi Corporation Transport Corporation case, year 1986, Supreme Court 1099. This brings us to the next aspect, proof beyond, as we were mentioning, in a criminal case. The burden of proof, according to the Indian Evidence Act, Chapter 7, is generally on the person who asserts. But in a civil case, there will be pleadings, assertions, and denials. Therefore, facts in issue would arise. But what about a criminal case? There is always a case of the prosecution. It is undeniable. That is why before the trial starts in a criminal case, the accusation or the charge is put to the accused. Then he pleads not guilty. Therefore, there is a denial, and hence the requirement of the prosecution proving its case would arise. It is well-known principle in English criminal jurisprudence that an accused is presumed to be innocent until the prosecution proves his guilt beyond reasonable doubt. An accused is presumed to be innocent throughout his trial. Since we have adopted the English criminal jurisprudence, it is the duty of the prosecution to establish all the ingredients of the offense with which the accused is charged, and it is for the prosecution to prove the offense beyond reasonable doubt in all criminal cases except where relevant statutes provides otherwise. The important decision on this aspect is Periyasamy's case, Periyasamy versus State of Tamil Nadu, 1997 Criminal Law Journal 219 Supreme Court. Thus, the first cardinal principle is that person arraigned as an accused is presumed to be innocent unless that presumption is rebutted by the prosecution by production of evidence as may show him to be guilty of the offense with which he is charged. The burden never shifts to the accused. So this one cardinal principle, which is always to be kept in view in our system of administration of justice, is the accused is always presumed to be innocent until the prosecution proves his guilt beyond reasonable doubt. This is the first cardinal principle so far as the standard of proof in a criminal case is concerned. So the burden of proving the guilt of the accused is upon the prosecution, and unless it relieves itself of the burden, the court cannot record a finding of the guilt of the accused. This we have to bear in mind. Then in criminal cases, when an accused is presumed to be innocent throughout the trial, and the burden of proof as to the guilt of the accused beyond reasonable doubt rests on the prosecution, the accused is not required to rebut the case of the prosecution until the guilt is sufficiently established beyond the shadow of doubt. So the accused in these cases is not required to give substantive evidence, unlike in civil cases. It is sufficient if he is able to create a reasonable doubt in the mind of the court as to his guilt. If that doubt is created, then it becomes necessary for him to prove the existence of circumstances bringing his case under the general exceptions pleaded, provided he pleads general exceptions, otherwise not. So before going to the general exceptions, let us talk of presumptions in criminal cases. We know that there are certain cases in which statutory presumptions arise regarding the guilt of the accused, but the burden in such cases, in my humble view, is upon the prosecution to prove the existence of facts which have to be presumed, which have to be present before the presumption can be drawn. So even in cases where there are presumptions in statutes relating to criminal cases, still the initial burden is on the prosecution to prove the existence of facts which are to be present before the presumption is drawn or the presumption exists. So in this case, I would like to mention an illustration. For example, NDPS, narcotic drugs and psychotropic substances cases. It envisages a reverse burden of proof with regard to culpable mental state of the accused. He is presumed to be guilty consequent to recovery of contraband from him, and it is for the accused to establish his innocence. In this regard, we have to refer to Hanif Khan's case of the Supreme Court. Though a presumption exists, and it is contrary to the normal rule of criminal jurisprudence that the accused is presumed to be innocent unless proved guilty, that does not absolve the prosecution from establishing a prima facie case, and unless a prima facie case is established, the burden never shifts the accused and the presumption has no role to play. For example, for denying this presumption under this act, the prosecution has to establish a prima facie case that the contraband is recovered from the accused. Unless this is established prima facie, the burden of proof never shifts to the accused. So because there is a reverse burden of proof, the prosecution shall be put to a strict test for compliance with statutory provisions. This is to be borne in mind so far as the criminal jurisprudence is concerned and presumptions in criminal jurisprudence. Then continuing with the standard of proof in a criminal prosecution, we have to take note of the fact once again of the cardinal criminal jurisprudence principles, namely presumption as to the innocence of the accused, proof beyond reasonable doubt, and number three, burden is always on the prosecution except where the accused pleads exceptions. Please refer to Kaliram's case, AER 1970 Supreme Court 2773, where these cardinal principles are very well explained by the Supreme Court. AER 1970 Supreme Court 2773, Kaliram's case. Now, the third principle I mentioned is burden is always on the prosecution except where the accused pleads exceptions. What is the relevant section? Section 105 of the Indian Evidence Act. When we read this section, we understand that this section raises a presumption against the accused and also throws a burden on him to rebut the said presumption. Under that section, the court shall presume the absence of circumstances bringing the case within any one of the exceptions, that is, the court shall regard the non-existence of such circumstances as proved till they are disproved. So, we can explain this based on an illustration. Following facts will bring out the meaning of the provision of Section 105. Before we go to the illustration, let me, for the sake of the youngsters, read the provision of law. Section 105 Indian Evidence Act, burden of proving that case of accused comes with an exception. The provision reads like this. When a person is accused of any offense, the burden of proving the existence of circumstances bringing the case within any of the general exceptions in the Indian Penal Code or within any special exceptions or proviso contained in any other part of the same code or any law defining the offense is upon him, and the court shall presume the absence of such circumstances. How we can explain this provision? What is the meaning? Supposing the prosecution alleges that the accused intentionally shot the deceased with a firearm, say a revolver, but the accused pleads that though the shot emanated from his revolver and hit the deceased, it was by accident. He says that the shot went off the revolver in the course of a struggle. So he pleads the general exception under Section 80, namely accident. So the defense of the accused under general exceptions is accident. But the court under the section 105 presumes absence of circumstances bringing the case within the provision of section 80 of the Indian Penal Code. So it is for the accused to prove that it's a case of accident. So the presumption has to be rebutted by the accused. How he rebuts the presumption? There are three ways. One, by adducing evidence to support his plea of accident in the circumstances which he mentions in his defense. The second, he can rebut the presumption by admissions made or circumstances elicited from the evidence of the prosecution. So by cross-examining the prosecution witnesses and the circumstances which are constituting the prosecution case, he can rebut the presumption. He need not always adduce the evidence. The third category is combined effect. He may adduce evidence and also rely upon the circumstances in the prosecution case and also the points that are elicited from the prosecution witnesses. So these are the three kinds of evidence on which he can rely to rebut the presumption. For example, the same case. The plea of the accused is it's an accident. The firearm went off during a struggle between him and the accused. Without adducing evidence, what are the circumstances on which he can rely? Supposing the bullet passed from underneath the chin into the head. If somebody shoots at a person from a distance, then the bullet generally will not pass from underneath the chin into the head. So this is a circumstance from the prosecution case he can rely upon to show that it may be an accident. Then the accused is having a licensed revolver. He has that revolver with the permission of the government to kill the wild animals which generally stray into the village. Generally, when he uses the revolver, he fires all the shots. In the cylinder, there are five chambers. He is used to firing all the bullets from all the chambers whenever he used the revolver in the past. But in this particular case, only one bullet was fired. And he says it's an accident. If he really intended to kill the deceased, he would have fired all the bullets from the revolver without taking any chance. So he relies upon another circumstance to prove that it's an accident. Like that, he can rebut the presumption from the circumstances of the prosecution case, or he may adduce evidence positively, or he may rely upon both the circumstances in the prosecution case or his evidence. And also the combination, namely the points elicited from the prosecution witnesses. For example, an eyewitness is there. He is in the witness box. While cross-examining him, the counsel for the accused poses a question. You have heard the shot which was fired, the sound of the shot that was fired? He says, yes. At that time, what is the position of the accused and the deceased? The witness says, they are both holding each other's hands. This point elicited suggests that the accused did not fire when the shot sound appeared or is heard by the witness. So this is a circumstance which the accused may rely by eliciting from the witness for the prosecution. That is how the presumption is rebutted. Then another important aspect is, even when the accused in his defense pleads any of the general exceptions contained in the penal code, the plea of the accused person may reach any of the following three stages. The plea of the defense of the accused defense plea of the accused, they reach only three stages. What are the stages? The first stage is lifting of the initial presumption raised at the end of Section 105 of the Indian Evidence Act, which we considered just now. The second stage is when a reasonable doubt as to the guilt of the accused is created. I stated the circumstances in which a doubt is created. The third stage is complete proof of the exception pleaded by preponderance of probabilities. These are the three stages. These three stages are mentioned in a landmark judgment, Rishikesh Singh's case, AER 1970, Allahabad, page 51. It is a decision which runs into more than 100 paragraphs where the entire case law was discussed. So when the plea of the accused does not go beyond the first stage, he is not entitled to acquittal. But when the plea of exception reaches the third stage, by proving it by preponderance of probabilities, he is naturally entitled to acquittal. Then what about the in-between case? The plea reaches the second stage. The majority opinion is, in such cases, the accused is entitled to a benefit of doubt. The accused is entitled to a benefit of doubt. These are the three stages. Now, coming back to our standard of proof. See, here is a case where there is a presumption in the statute book reversing the burden on the accused. Or here is a case where the accused pleaded a general exception. Then how the defense can establish the general exception and how the defense can rebut the presumption which is contained in a statute book. What is the standard of evidence which the accused is required to adduce in both the cases? In Haribhajan Singh's case, AER 1966, Supreme Court, page 97, it was observed at page 101 as follows. Where the burden of an issue lies on the accused, he is not required to discharge the burden by leading evidence to prove his case beyond a reasonable doubt. That is the test prescribed only for the prosecution. When an accused person is called upon to prove that his case falls under general exception, law treats the onus as discharged if the accused person succeeds in proving a preponderance of probability. So when an accused person is called upon to prove that his case falls under an exception, law treats that onus as discharged if the accused succeeds in proving a preponderance of probability. So far as the defense is concerned, the standard of proof in a criminal case is preponderance of probability, though for the prosecution, it is proof beyond reasonable doubt. So these are some important aspects about standard of proof in a criminal case. Then continuing on this aspect of principles of criminal jurisprudence, it is also apt to note the following aspects. The golden thread which runs through the cobweb of criminal jurisprudence is that 9 guilty may escape, but 1 innocent should not suffer. There are also principles beneficial to the accused in criminal jurisprudence, namely, benefit of doubt, right to silence, right of opportunity under Section 313 of the CRPC to explain the incriminating circumstances in the evidence of the prosecution, right to be heard on the measure of sentence, rules of prudence like looking for corroborating and assuring material, etc. So these are some beneficial principles in the criminal jurisprudence, which also are favorable to the accused. All the above features in a criminal law clearly emphasize that the standard of proof in a criminal case is higher than in a civil case. Like, for example, what is the meaning of looking for corroboration or assuring material? See, when we go to accomplice, there are two provisions in the Indian Evidence Act. One is Section 133. Which says, An accomplice shall be a competent witness against an accused person, and a conviction is not illegal merely because it proceeds upon the uncorroborated testimony of an accomplice. So this section says that accomplice who is a partner in crime, if he gives evidence on behalf of the prosecution, a conviction is not illegal merely because it proceeds upon the uncorroborated testimony of an accomplice. But section 114 illustration B of the Indian Evidence Act says an accomplice is unworthy of credit. An accomplice is unworthy of credit unless his testimony is corroborated by material particulars. So it appears from these two provisions there is a conflict. But the Supreme Court resolved the conflict and said that though it is not illegal to base a conviction on the uncorroborated testimony of an accomplice, yet he being a partner of the crime, it is always necessary to look for material corroboration. It is a rule of prudence. So that is how the Supreme Court held that it is necessary for the prosecution to prove material corroboration of an accomplice's evidence. Then another golden thread that runs through the cobweb of criminal jurisprudence and what is required in criminal cases is that when two views are possible on the evidence adduced in the case, one pointing to the guilt of the accused and the other to the innocence, the view which is favorable to the accused must be preferred, that must be adopted. This principle has a special relevance in cases where the guilt of the accused is being sought to be established by circumstantial evidence. A rule has accordingly been laid down that unless the evidence adduced in the case is consistent not only with the hypothesis of the guilt of the accused and is inconsistent with that of his innocence, the court should refrain from regarding a finding of the guilt. So when two views are possible, the view favorable to the accused must be adopted. And when evidence is adduced in a case, the evidence must not only be consistent with the hypothesis of the guilt of the accused and must be inconsistent with that of his innocence. Then only a finding of guilt can be recorded. Coming once again to the benefit of doubt, to deal with it in detail, it is an accepted rule that in case the court entertains a reasonable doubt regarding the guilt of the accused must have the benefit of doubt. Of course, the doubt regarding the guilt of the accused should be reasonable. It is not the doubt of a mind which is either so vacillating that it is incapable of reaching a firm conclusion or so timid that it is hesitant and afraid to take things to their natural consequences. The rule regarding benefit of doubt also does not warrant acquittal of the accused by reason by resorting to surmises, conjectures, and fanciful considerations. These are the guidelines given in a decision, State of Punjab versus Jagir Singh, 1973 Supreme Court AER. I did not note the page number, I'm sorry. State of Punjab versus Jagir Singh, 1973 Supreme Court AER. So it is to be re-emphasized, although the benefit of every reasonable doubt should be given to the accused, the court should not at the same time reject the evidence which is ex facie trustworthy on grounds which are fanciful or in the nature of conjectures. This is about benefit of doubt. Another important aspect is, it is a primary principle, in fact, that the accused must be and merely must be and not merely may be guilty before a court can convict him. The accused must be guilty and not merely may be guilty. The material distinction between may be and must be is a long and dividing factor. Therefore, vague conjectures and the primary principle is that the accused must be and not merely may be guilty before a court can convict, and the mental distinction between may be and must be maintained. Kaliram's case, I have already given the citation, Kaliram's case, 1973 Supreme Court. Now, standards of proof, and now let us turn to burden of proof vis-a-vis onus of proof. Burden of proof, in my humble view, is understood in two senses. Firstly, it means establishing the whole case. Burden of proof means establishing the whole case. Secondly, it means a particular stage of the proceeding. So there are two kinds of senses in the words burden of proof. It means establish. Secondly, it means introducing evidence at any particular stage of the proceeding. So there is an essential distinction between burden of proof and onus of proof. Burden of proof, person who has to prove a fact, and it never shifts. Therefore, it is called legal burden. But the onus of proof shifts. Therefore, in my humble view, onus of proof is evidentiary burden. Onus of proof is evidentiary burden. And it never, burden of legal proof, burden of proof which is a legal burden never shifts, whereas the onus of proof which is an evidentiary burden shifts from side to side during the course of trial and also during evaluation of evidence. This essential distinction between the two must be maintained. Please refer to A. Raghavamma versus A. Chanchamma, AER 1964, Supreme Court 136. Then how we have to deal with the onus of proof? See, for example, in a civil case, the promissory note recites that the consideration has been given by means of a bank check. The defense of the accused is that the consideration did not pass. He files his bank account and shows that the check number which is mentioned in the promissory note was not encashed by him, and the consideration under the said check did not pass to him. So the onus of proof is discharged by the defendant, and the onus to introduce evidence shifted to the plaintiff to prove that the consideration passed. The plaintiff may adduce evidence. No doubt the check number mentioned in the promissory note is a wrong number. The last digit should have been 5 instead of 4. The check number is wrongly mentioned in the promissory note because of the last digit wrongly being mentioned. In fact, the consideration passed. The real check is with the correct number. It is encashed. The plaintiff produces the evidence of the banker to show that the check with that number which is mentioned in the plaint pleading is really encashed by the defendant. Again, the onus shifts to the defendant to prove as to whether the second check which the plaintiff is mentioning in his pleadings and evidence is encashed or not. That is how during course of the trial, the evidence, the onus shifts from side to side. Another example, suit for recovery of possession based on title. We know the standard rule, stood for recovery position in a based on title, the burden is on the plaintiff. The plaintiff must succeed on his own strength, but he cannot rely upon the weakness of the defense. Then, how the onus works here? Is the proof a strict standard of proof like in a criminal case, or it is proof based on preponderance of probabilities? As we have noticed from Raghavamma's case, there is an essential distinction between burden of proof and onus of proof. Burden of proof lies upon a person who has to prove the fact and which never shifts. Onus of proof shifts. Then what is this shifting? The answer is in R.V.E. Venkatachal Gowda's case of the Supreme Court. It is a decision rendered in the year 2003. The Supreme Court opined that in a suit for possession based on title, once the plaintiff has been able to create a high degree of probability as to his title, the onus shifts to the defendant. If the defendant fails to adduce any evidence and discharge the burden which shifted upon him, then proved. The onus of proof shifts from side to side. Here we have to bear in mind one more aspect. When there are facts in issue and which are to be proved by the parties, and when on some issues the burden is on the plaintiff and on the other issues the burden is on the defendant, then we have to look at Order 18 of the Code. Evidence is to be adduced on several issues. Rule 3 says, where there are several issues, the burden of proving some of which lies on the plaintiff, but on the rest issues, the burden lies on the other party, then the plaintiff who begins the suit may at his option either produce his evidence on those issues on which the burden is on the defendant, or reserve his right to adduce evidence by way of answer the evidence that may be produced by the defendant on such issues on which the burden of proof lies on the defendant. That is how the onus of proof shifts from side to side, either in a civil case where there are presumptions or where there are no presumptions. Similarly, in a criminal case, when the presumptions are pleaded or are there in the statute book, or when general exceptions are pleaded, the burden is on the defendant, provided a prima facie case for drawing a presumption is made by the prosecution, or when the accused is able to discharge his burden by adducing evidence only to the extent of preponderance of probabilities to discharge his burden. With these few submissions, I thank the audience for the patient hearing. This. Sorry, sir, I am not in my usual self today. I am sure I am of the view that I did not justify. I
mean, no, sir, it's fine.
I'm not in my usual self today.
No, we are all enjoying the session.
Okay, sir.
Thank you. In fact, Sandeep has been kind enough to share the judgments which you are sharing.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Anything else, sir? Any panelists would share their views on this?
Yes, sir. Two questions have been posted so far. Advocate Sachin Anand, what is the legal position on confrontation of a document during evidence without producing it in the court earlier?
See, documents can be produced at three stages. One is for the plaintiff along with his pleadings. For the defendant, along with the pleadings, that is the settled legal position. Then for both parties, there is another opportunity to produce documentary evidence with the leave of the court. That is the second category. The third category is only for the defendant. he can produce documents at two stages. See, the plaintiff, the defendant receives a notice. He has 3 months time under law for filing his written statement. He can file all his documents along with the written statement. But in the meanwhile, within this 3 months period, an interlocutory application comes up for hearing. At that stage also, the defendant can file his documents. That does not prevent him from filing his documents again, if any left out, along with the written statement. These are the stages at which the documents will be filed. Then one more stage at which the documents can be filed is confrontation to the witness, a document during cross-examination. There need not be a prior notice. For this, there is a Delhi High Court ruling that any document can be produced during cross-examination. The witness who is being cross-examined need not be an author of the document when it is confronted to him. If he is somehow connected with the document, either as a attester or having knowledge of the document, having earlier seen it, he can be confronted with the document during the cross-examination. And the Salem Bar Association case number 2 also, the Supreme Court clarified that such a document can be confronted to the evidence, to the witness during the cross-examination. These are the stages in which the document can be produced by the party. I hope I am clear.
Yes, sir. This is by Ayushi Mishra. In civil cases, if there are presumptions, to what standard should the evidence be produced?
Presumptions? So far as the presumptions is concerned, the standard, because the presumption is not by itself evidence, as I was mentioning earlier. Presumption only makes out a prima facie case in favor of the party in whose favor it exists. I also mentioned an illustration from the civil law, that is 118 of the Negotiable Instruments Act, and also under the NDPS Act, and have given Hanafi's case, which is the recent decision of the Supreme Court. Presumption being only a rule of evidence and not any evidence by itself, it only indicates on whom the initial onus of proof lies. Like, for example, I'll repeat the illustration, same illustration. Toot on the foot of a promissory note. Either the defendant admits the execution, or by some evidence the plaintiff proves that the defendant executed the promissory note. So there are some known facts or proved facts or admissions before the court to the extent that the execution of the promissory note is proved. Then 118 of the Negotiable Instruments Act says, once execution is admitted or proved, the presumption is that the consideration passed. Therefore, in such a case, the onus is on the defendant to rebut the presumption. Be it a civil case or a criminal case, when the onus shifts to the other opposite party, the proof can only by the standard preponderance of probabilities.
Ganesh Tiwari says, how can we prove a malicious prosecution?
Malicious prosecution, it's very difficult to prove. In 277 Law Commission report, there is a beautiful discussion on this preponderance of probabilities. I mean, malicious prosecution. The Law Commission suggested that after facing trial and after being incarcerated for some time during the course of trial and pre-trial procedures, the accused is cleanly acquitted. Then there is no settled law in the country for compensating such accused who is acquitted after incarceration and long trial. Then what is to be done? The 277 Law Commission report suggested that the state must take initiative and create a system of compensating such accused who are acquitted after incarceration and a clean acquittal is recorded. I would like to mention from that if I can find readily.
So Sandeep has otherwise posted the Law Commission report on the WhatsApp.
277 report, yes sir. If you can do that, well and good.
No, he has posted on the group.
Okay.
If you tell the relevant page, I can ask Sandeep to share that particular page.
Yes sir, yes sir. I'll try to give you. We'll go to the next question. In the meanwhile,
If documents have been marked during the cross-examination without any pleadings to that effect in the plaint or written statement, what is the legal position in that case?
If he can illustrate, I can better explain. But the settled legal position is any amount of evidence without a pleading is of no relevance. Any amount of evidence without a pleading, without a foundation in the pleading, is of no consequence. It cannot be looked into.
Okay.
See, for certain aspects, there need not be a pleading. For example, it's a suit on the foot of a promissory note once again, or it is a suit where the document is a compulsorily attestable document. The suit is based on compulsorily attestable document, like a gift deed, like a will deed. Then a witness is confronted. An attester has come to prove the due execution of the document. He is confronted with a document, namely a photograph, to show that on the date the will was executed at New Delhi, he was attending a marriage in Mumbai. He admits the photograph and his presence in Mumbai on that day. See, for this, no pleading is necessary. It's a matter of evidence. Shows that the witness is not present in Delhi when the will is allegedly executed at Delhi by the testator. He was at Mumbai, therefore there is no possibility of this witness being present at Delhi and attesting the document. Therefore, it all depends upon the facts and circumstances of the case. Supposing if it is a material fact that is sought to be proved by cross-examination by giving a document to the witness, then the rule that no amount of evidence can be looked into without a foundation in the pleadings would apply. Then what is a material fact or what is a material proposition? Material fact is one, in case of plaintiff, which constitutes the cause of action, which the plaintiff is required to prove to succeed and get the relief in the suit. Similarly, a material fact for the defendant is such fact which the defendant has to prove to succeed in his defense. If those material facts, on those material facts, a document is confronted to a witness and then it is marked, but the relevant pleading regarding that document is not there in the pleading, then any amount of evidence cannot be looked into because there is no foundation in the pleading.
Yes. Manju, in a partition suit, should the defendant examine himself first and subject to cross-examination? Or the attesting witness of a will is to be examined. D3 has led examination in chief. DW1 and got marked several documents as exhibit D series.
D series?
Yeah. Defendants only.
I see. See, in our civil rules of practice, we mark documents in four categories. A series for the plaintiff, B series for the defendant, C series. C series for the court, and X series for the witnesses. That is how we mark the documents.
Out here we only write PW1 and DW1.
PW1 and DW1. PW1 is the plaintiff witness, DW1 is the defense witness.
how do we write out there in for the court court document?
Court document is C series court document. Namely, suppose a commissioner's report is filed, it will not be returned to any of the parties. It is a part of the court record. It will be marked as a C1, C2, C3, like that. Commissioner's plan is C2, commissioner's report is C1. Supposing the question is, the witness is not the scribe of the document. The witness comes and says, I scribed the document. His evidence is disputed. He is given a piece of white paper and some material is dictated to him in the court hall. And as a witness, he scribes what is dictated. That piece of paper with his handwriting is marked for comparison tomorrow with the disputed handwriting. It will be marked in C series. Because it is written in the court hall, it is nobody's document.
Okay. And D1, how do you substantiate that?
X1 is a witness document, X series. Supposing an MRO is summoned to produce a revenue record. It will be returned again to the government. It must go to the government. So to indicate that it is not, neither of the parties are entitled to return of the document, we'll mark it in X series. X1, X2, X2, like that. A witness brings a document, it will be returned to the witness only.
After showing the original one.
Yes. Except those documents which are superseded will not be returned. Suppose a suit promissory note is there. Suit is decreed or dismissed. Promissory note will be superseded by drawing lines across it. It will not be returned to anybody. So in case of a will, who is to be first examined? See, the plaintiff files a suit on the basis of his father's will. Naturally, his father is no more. So he has to prove the will to get the property that is bequeathed under the will to him. So he is the propounder. He must be first examined. He will formally mark the will for identification. Mere marking is not proof. There is a distinction between marking and proof. As we all know, marking is not proof. The will be proved by calling upon an attester. Because will is a compulsorily attestable document under the Indian Succession Act, like a mortgage deed is a compulsorily attestable document under the Transfer of Property Act, so also gift deed under the Transfer of Property Act. The fourth document is bond under the Stamp Act, which is a compulsorily attestable document. But the AP High Court full bench said, simply because a bond is not attested when it is not having all the ingredients, still it will be a bond because the definition under the Indian Stamp Act is only an inclusive definition. So there are only now three kinds of documents which are compulsorily attestable: mortgage deed, gift deed or settlement deed, and then will deed.
Manju takes her question a step forward. It says, in this case, the will was produced by the defendants. Plaintiff is not aware of the will.
See, whether the defendant pleaded the will in the written statement.
Okay. I understand. This is all
particular. The will in the written statement, and the copy of the written statement is served upon the plaintiff, it is the duty of the plaintiff to file a rejoinder, if necessary, with the permission of the court, denying or accepting the will. And if the will copy is not supplied, he must bring it to the notice of the court that the defendant pleaded a will, filed it with the written statement, the original will, but a copy is not served. Then the court will direct a copy to be given. Otherwise, he can inspect the will by seeking permission of the court and then file a rejoinder, either accepting or denying the will.
Gopi says, what are the circumstances where the defendant has to commence the trial first?
When the initial onus of proof is on the defendant. That is why I said the issues must be preframed always in the affirmative. If the issues are framed in the affirmative and all the issues are in the affirmative, means the plaintiff must get into the box. Like, again, I'll come back to the same question. A suit is based on a will. The plaintiff says that the property mentioned in the will is the separate property of the father. It is also the suit schedule property. All the property is bequeathed to him. Based on the said will, the plaintiff filed a suit. The defendant sets up a plea in the defendant, who is the brother of the plaintiff, says the will is a forged will. In the absence of a will, succession law would apply. both the plaintiff and defendant will be entitled to a half share each in the father's property, and the father died intestate is the defense. Then the issue will be whether the will dated so-and-so said to have been executed by the father of the parties is true. Who asserts the will is true? The plaintiff asserts. The rule of evidence is he who asserts must prove. Therefore, the plaintiff must prove the will. Supposing, take a case. The defense is the will is executed by the father is correct, but the property is not the separate property of the father. It is ancestral property. Nature of the property is disputed. So far as the proof of the will is concerned, the burden is not on the plaintiff. The will is admitted. By admission, the will is proved. The only question is whether the property is separate property of the father or the ancestral property as contended by the defendant. If the property is the ancestral property, father has a right only to execute a will to the extent of his share, but he cannot execute a will for the entire property. Therefore, the will would be valid only to the extent of the share of the father. Even in such a case also, the burden is on the plaintiff to prove whether the property is a separate property or ancestral property, because the initial onus of proof, that is the legal burden, is on the plaintiff. If the plaintiff proves, adduces his evidence, then the onus shifts to the defendant to prove his defense. Then after both parties adduce evidence, then the rule of burden of proof fails into insignificance, and that it's for the court to base on the evidence, to base its decision on the evidence adduced.
This question is posted on the Facebook. This is by Anshu Agarwal. A document marked in the cross is taken on record. So the party putting the document in cross, if it is denied by the other party, the party who had put the document in cross can be allowed to prove the document. Exception is that the party shall not be taking advantage to prove the document which he should have duty to prove for establishing his own case. That is his take. I thought it's a question. The last question is by Sanjay. In a suit along with other issue whether the document dated is so, is the last legally valid executed will of the deceased is framed, and the onus is on D1 to prove the same after the case D1 files the test case. Whether that will be considered to be proved.
No, I'm not able to follow the question.
So I think that question also requires a reframing, but still I will try to frame it. In a suit, one of the issue framed was whether a document dated so is the last legally valid executed will of the deceased is framed, and the onus is on DW1 to prove the same. After the same DW1 files a test case, now will be considered to be proved?
When the question is whether the will executed by so and so is the last will, it's a question of fact. It all depends upon the facts of the case and the evidence adduced.
Right. We will not be taking any questions, but I'm just telling the tomorrow's session. Tomorrow's webinar would be Law of Mortgages with Special Reference to Banking Law by Mr. S.P. Shankar, Senior Advocate, Karnataka High Court. Do stay connected with us at 5 p.m. And sir, I would like to share that today on the Facebook, there are a lot of participants who are watching. I will share with you the screenshot. It only shows that the knowledge which you have shared, people have actually cherished it, because there is a consistent growing strength of the Facebook. I'll share the screenshot. And
I don't think I did justice today to my talk.
I can only humbly say it is just like Tendulkar getting out at 90 and he feels that he couldn't score 100, but at least we all enjoyed.
Yeah, thank you so much. It's nice of you.
No. Actually, the subject was such to juxtapose everything, burden of proof, onus of proof, and standards of proof. Is a job which only an expert can make you understand. So, in fact, we are all delighted the way you have expressed the things.
And we are all enamored the way you have expressed it. And thank you to all the participants who have watched us live on the Facebook, as well as on those who have participated in this platform. And on behalf of all the participants who will also watch us on the our channel of Beyond Law CLC, since this video will be uploaded, from all the participants who have watched and who have enriched their knowledge from a speaker who has shared his knowledge in his profuse manner and decimating knowledge, which will go down in their memories. On their behalf, I thank Justice M.S.R. Murthy. Thank you for sparing the time and sharing your knowledge with us. We're all thankful to you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Namaskar, Jai Hind.